Good morning and welcome to this teleconferencing session of PGD HHM program. Friends, in the last teleconferencing which was held on in the month last month, we have covered the topics of clinical diagnostic and therapeutic services, and we also touched upon the medical record department and sterile CSSD department also. Today, what we'll be doing, that we'll be covering, if you see your course 5 and course 6, probably this will be the last teleconferencing session of the season. So we'll try to finish as much as we can do. And so we'll be taking the remaining portion of course 5, that is sport and utility services, and the course 6, that is health systems management. And my request to all of you will be that because since this is the last teleconferencing, unless until there are some questions and you want to have another, maybe then we can have one next month also. So my request to all of you will be that if there are any questions, queries, you are feel free to ask to our experts who are present there, and they will be more than happy to reply to your queries and questions. So now, in this first session of teleconferencing, we'll be talking about a very important area. And if you see that in your course 5, there is a one unit on sanitation and waste management. So we'll be talking about that particular unit. And to discuss about that, we have in our studio Colonel S.K.M. Rao. Welcome, Dr. S.K.M. Rao. And to cover other topics, we have got with us Dr. Pramod Gandhi. He is the program in charge of one of our program study center in Delhi. So welcome, Dr. Gandhi.
Thank you.
So I think without wasting any time, I will request Colonel Rao to just tell our students, sir, what are the various aspects of waste management and how in a hospital that waste is being managed, and then maybe what are the feature that our students, some practical tips to our students so that they can manage this.
Today we will be talking about biomedical waste management. As Professor Arora has brought out, that biomedical waste management is a very important area in the hospital, being a statutory requirement. As you are well aware, that most of the people actually in the health field, also in the hospitals, are already aware about biomedical waste management because of its statutory nature, and various rules and regulations surrounding that are also very much known to you. But we will go into the details of this one by one. Biomedical waste management and handling rules 1998, as you are all aware, are there to guide us in this regard. Also various amendments which have taken place after that. So biomedical waste is any waste which is generated during the diagnosis, treatment or immunization of human beings or animals, or in research activities pertaining thereto, or in the production of testing biologicals, and including categories mentioned in Schedule 1 of Gazette Notification. Various categories we will go through one by one: human anatomical waste, animal waste, then microbiology and biotechnology waste, then we have waste sharps, discarded medicines and cytotoxic drugs, then soiled waste. This category is very, very important category. As you know, is also soiled with blood, body fluids, which is important for all the types of hospitals. Then we have solid waste, liquid waste, incineration ash, and chemical waste. Then health impacts of this waste is also important. It contains infectious agents, it contains toxic chemicals or pharmaceuticals, it contains sharps, exposure results in disease or injury, which are the persons which are at the risk: medical doctors, nurses, paramedical workers, patients, visitors, then workers in the support services, and also workers in the waste disposal facilities, like you have a common biomedical treatment facilities. Those workers are also very, very important, and they are at risk of all these hazards of the waste. Then there are various other hazards from infectious waste and sharps, as you are all aware. Needle stick injuries is the most important hazard, which is there and which is through the sharps. Then other hazards like through inhalation, through ingestion, and through the mucous membrane also, these impact of infectious waste is there. HIV, AIDS, hepatitis B, C, this is all is very, very important from the transmission point of view. Then, as I was telling you earlier also, that on July 20th, 1998, Government of India has actually notified biomedical waste management and handling rules. And there are many amendments to that later on, but those are very, very minor amendments. And up to the 2000, there have been a lot of amendments to these rules. And in the light of gazette notification, it is very, very important for all the hospitals to follow these rules very meticulously. There are various major sources of healthcare waste like hospitals, other healthcare establishments like emergency medical care services, outpatient clinics, dialysis centers, then transfusion centers, and various other laboratories and standalone diagnostic centers, blood banks, which are major sources of healthcare waste. There are various minor sources also, like you have polyclinics, doctors' clinics, or private practitioners, and various nursing homes. And at home also, we carry out a lot of home care services. Those are also minor sources of healthcare waste. Then various categories, we will go into the details of these categories, like 1, 2, 3, and 6 are to be disposed of through the yellow bags. Human tissues, organs, body parts. In animal waste, various animal tissues are there. In microbiology and biotechnology, as far as hospital is concerned, is basically cultures and stocks of the waste, which we have in the microbiology laboratory. Then we have waste sharps, like needles, syringes, scalpels. Then we have discarded medicines and cytotoxic drugs. Soiled waste is very, very important category, where is very, very common category rather, I would say, that we keep on using various types of dressings, we keep on using it for the injections, swabs, all these go into this category, which are soiled with the blood or body fluids. Then waste generated from the disposable items, or you can say your plastic waste also comes under this category. Then there is a liquid waste, incineration ash, and various types of chemical waste which are there. Then there are disposal mechanisms for each type of category. Human anatomical waste and animal waste is most preferable is through the incineration. Then microbiology waste is most preferable is through the autoclaving. Waste sharps are supposed to be mutilated, shredded, or to be put into the waste sharp pits. Discarded medicines and cytotoxic drugs are to be incinerated. Soiled waste can be autoclaved or disinfected at the source and then taken for incineration or even for the autoclaving. Solid waste is again disinfection by chemical treatment followed by autoclaving. Liquid waste is disinfection by chemical treatment and discharge into the drains. Then I have also put on the view foil for you various types of waste segregation and disposal. So you can see clearly there that there is a overlap between red bag and yellow bag, which creates a lot of confusion. So in fact, the Delhi Pollution Control Board has different rules from other pollution control boards because there is a confusion between these two categories. So each state pollution control board is following its own norms, but by and large they have to stick to the main norms of biomedical waste management and handling rules. In that, human anatomical waste, animal waste, microbiology, and soiled waste can go into the yellow bag also, and this soiled waste category and microbiology waste category can go into the red bag also. But you will notice this also, that human anatomical waste, that is your tissues and various amputated limbs and other things which come out from the operation theater, has to have an incineration mechanism only, and that is in the yellow bag. So blue bag is meant basically for your recycling of plastic waste or non-infected plastic waste. Then black bag can carry discarded medicines, regular general waste, and other categories. Then this is again shown on your view foil that how to segregate various types of waste. Sorry for using the green color for general waste, but general color used is a black color for general waste. Infected waste is red, plastic waste is blue, and human tissues is in the yellow, and sharps is again puncture proof containers. Then further cycle follows from the segregation up to the collection points also. You need to have those drums, then followed by the final treatment procedure. You can see over the general waste, we can go in for vermicomposting also, as well as it can go on to the municipal waste also. Whereas infected waste has to be treated either through the autoclave, hydroclave or incinerators. Then plastic waste can be shredded and recycled also through the vendors after, of course, the disinfection is done. Human tissues has to go to the incinerator only, and the sharps, as I have shown, can go to the waste, you know, sharp pits. Then these are the labels to be used for biomedical waste on each bags as well as on the containers. These are, you are aware about these biohazard symbols or cytotoxic wherever oncology waste is there, where there you have to use cytotoxic hazard symbol. And various types of treatment and disposal technologies also I will show you one by one. Authorization is a very, very important aspect. Most of the hospitals still I find that they do not have any authorization from the government of India or the state government, and it happens that they have either applied for it and no reply has come, and the hospitals are not taking that much interest to review this aspect. This is a, mind you, this is a very, very statutory requirement and a very mandatory requirement to have a pre-authorization for handling biomedical waste as per the rules. Now, Government of India as well as various state governments have promulgated that all other rules also come, which come under the environmental rule, have been combined. For example, your generators or various types of water pollution, all that has been combined into one authorization. And maybe that is why some time is taken by pollution control boards to issue you with authorization. But this is a very, very important aspect as far as statutory requirement is concerned, that every hospital and healthcare facility must have the authorization from government to handle the waste. Then you need to have an advisory committee at the state level, and in various other establishments like defense also, we have to have a state-wise advisory committee for this purpose. Then you need to have an annual report submitted to the prescribed authority, that is on 31st January. This date should be remembered by every hospital administrator, being a statutory requirement, and this must reach them in a prescribed format. Then the records have to be maintained by everybody in the hospital, that is waste management officer and other nominated officers which are there, and that has to be as per format. Then the accident reporting format is given in the biomedical waste management and handling rules, that has to be followed. Then appeal can be done against these authorities if there are any problem areas. Then now government has come up with the common disposal, or CBTWF, what we call common biomedical treatment facilities. That also we will see what are the implications of that. Hospital waste management structure must be understood by everybody, that you need to have, being a statutory requirement, you must have a separate waste management officer designated who can handle all this along with various departmental heads as well as various other paramedical personnel which provide support to this particular person. He is directly responsible to the head of the hospital, being a statutory requirement. I am repeating this again and again. Waste generated each month by waste category, he has to monitor in each department, treatment and disposal methods being followed, various financial aspects like direct cost of supplies, training costs, cost of operation, maintenance, cost for various contractor services like per bed you are giving some biomedical waste for final disposal. Various public health aspects have to be also monitored in respect of injuries, near misses, or failures in handling, separation, storage. These are important aspects. This is the format which is shown on your view foil. That waste collection point can be outlined here, each and every waste collection point. Then waste category can be specified, then the quantity of waste generated by weight and volume has to be specified on each day. Then this is to be signed by the waste management officer, and this is to be reported to the head of the institution. Other policies are there of waste minimization, that is reduce, reuse and recycle. What we call for waste minimization is very, very important, where you actually do the source reduction as well as have your usage in the stock management according to that, and then you can reduce some of the waste. That can be done by assessing the waste, then local treatment and disposal options can be seen. Segregation of healthcare waste from general waste has to be done, and various other types of choices which I said, reduce, reuse and recycle, these can be taken care of when you are minimizing your healthcare waste, which is a must, as well as this is a national requirement now to reduce the waste. Various types of technology like incinerator, you have a primary chamber, you have a secondary chamber. In secondary chamber, actually the temperature has to go very high, and then only it is very effective, and it has to be more than 1200 degrees centigrade, where you can actually control various types of pollutants coming out of this thing. Then venturi scrubber is a must now as per the rules, where various pollutants can be washed away in the gases which go away from the incinerator. Then the autoclave again has to be maintained for biological treatment, as well as various chemical and thermal treatments which need to be monitored. That means the temperature has to be monitored, the pressure has to be monitored, then bacteriological quality has to be monitored for autoclaving. Another option is that hydroclave, which is also very, very popular, but cannot be used for body tissues. And this hydroclave is just like an autoclave, but it has a rotor inside and partially shreds the waste and increases the surface area so that it becomes more effective. Then is microwave. Microwave is being increasingly used in various hospitals. What we call a multi-option treatment. You can either use microwave, hydroclave, autoclave or incinerator. That is what government also says so in the biomedical waste management and handling rules. For different types of waste, you have different options which are important options, and microwaving is also one of the important options being used. Chemical disinfection is actually, you have to first chemically disinfect, then only use other options which are available to you like autoclaving and microwaving. So chemical disinfection is also a very, very important aspect of final disposal. Then these are multi-optional approach, as I said earlier. Then common treatment facility, I'll say a word about this. Then in common treatment facility has saved a lot of capital investment of each hospital. Then it has also saved us from a lot of pollution, which used to take place if every hospital facility has to have an incinerator. So it can be done centrally, and a lot of training on the final disposal also can be saved because a single agency is doing this at one particular place. So training, as I said, is very, very important, in which specifically ward boys, safai karmacharis and various types of administrators which are involved are major foot soldiers, what we call is the safai karmachari, which needs to be trained in this in all respects, whether it is handling, whether it is segregation, whether it is transporting, and various options which we use. Even during the final treatment options also, these people have been used for segregating the waste and separating it. Then we have a lot of guidelines about common biomedical waste treatment facilities. Like, you have to have this almost 1 acre land has to be given for this. Location should be away from the main city, and 150 kilometer area it can cover, and approximately 10,000 beds it is supposed to cover, so that it becomes a cost effective option for everybody. So whether it is the supplier, or whether it is the person who is taking care of that, or also for the hospitals, it becomes a cost effective facility. So this takes care of common biomedical treatment facility in terms of incineration, autoclaving, microwaving, hydroclaving, shredders. These all can be installed in one place, and various options can be utilized for different types of waste, so that as per the rules. and sharp pits, vehicle container washing facility, effluent treatment facility. This all needs to be there in the CBWTF. And cost can be different, decided by the state government. That is what authority, which is their state pollution control boards, and that is how we can arrive at this common cost. It is approximately at present 15 to 20 rupees per kg waste per bed. And I think I have gone through this waste management.
Thank you, Colonel Rao. I think Colonel Rao has very comprehensively covered that topic of waste management. He has told you about what are the general rules, what are the statutory rules for disposal of waste management. Then what are the various types of waste, solid waste, liquid waste, and the radioactive waste. Then he has also told you about what are the various methods of disposal. And then how this before disposal, that how it has to be treated, the various methods of treatment. And then he also talked about that what are the various policies and practices for waste administration. That also he talked about. The most important thing which I think he has told you, that the training of the staff is very important. Because if you see that even if the rules are in place, people know that thing, but if the people are not trained that how to implement those things, then there is no point in having any policy, anything. So the all the personnels who are basically dealing with the dealing with the waste management or who are handling the waste, they must be trained. I think that that is a very important component. And this training will again depends upon the individual needs of the hospitals. That has to develop by the hospital administrator concerned in accordance with the what is the existing practices in the hospital, what is required as per the rules, what are the gaps, and then you identify your training needs and train the staff, various categories of staff, right from the ward boy to the top level. People need to be trained. I think that is very important component, because unless until people are trained, they are aware of these things, these rules will be on paper, there will be policy on the paper, there will be various registers will be there, and all those things will be there, but they will be not implemented. And Dr. Gandhi, would you like to add something to that waste management?
Yeah, I think Colonel Rao has covered excellently. The only thing which he has emphasized is to be remembered again and again is there should be a medical officer designated for the waste management, with the host of the clinical staff, including the nursing administrator, to be reporting directly to the management. And training component, which is as equally as important.
And if you see, then when we are talking about this waste management, certain precautions have to be taken when we are dealing with that, the radioactive
yes.
material. That can you tell the?
Yeah, actually speaking, radioactive waste is categorized under the AERB rules. It is not exactly under the biomedical waste management and handling rules, but it is very, very important to treat this nuclear waste, what we call, as per the guidelines of AERB, in terms of basically it is about the half-life of these waste, where you need to store this waste for a temporary storage area has to be designated, where this waste can be stored for some time and then taken care of after the half-life is over. Most of the times, if you see that we are using in our nuclear medicine facilities with a very, very less half-life period, especially for the diagnostic purposes only. Therapeutic purposes, very few institutions in India are actually using it for therapeutic purposes. And those isotopes which are used for therapeutic purposes, there we need to take more care, where we need to have a storage for the sewage also, where storage of sewage is also there to be for the half-life of those isotopes, and then only this can be thrown into the normal sewage treatment, and after that it can be disposed of in a drainage. And that is the main thing.
I think we'll not go into what are the harmful effects of the hospital waste. I think you must all be aware that if hospital waste is not treated properly and disposed properly, there are so many hazards which are given in book, and I think you must be knowing. But still, if there is any question from the students sitting here in the studio or sitting at the various regional centers, if there is any question pertaining to this waste management, you feel free to ask our experts. So we'll start with another topic, but even then, if there is some question related, if it comes to your mind, you can stop us in between and ask your question. So now we will go on to another important area. If you see that your course 5, dietary services is another important area which we have not covered in the last teleconferencing. And you all will agree with me that although it is a very sportive type of department, it's not given much importance by at least the medical personnel. They are not bothered about that, how the dietary services are being taken care of, how whether the patient is getting the right type of diet or not, and what could be the harmful effects if the person is not getting the proper, and maybe what are the various types of malpractices which are taking in the dietary services. Some pilferage of material is going on. Maybe if the proper procedures are not followed, then the patients admitted in the hospital may have infections also. So many things can happen. So I think we need to look into this type of, we need to explore what are the various organizational administrative aspects in dietary services. And I will again request Colonel Rao to tell you about that, what is this, how to organize this dietary services and how to administer, and what are the various precautions which need to be keep in this particular department in order to avoid the any untoward incidents in the hospital.
So as Professor Arora has brought out, certain administrative aspects of dietary services. So you have to think in this direction, that dietary services have two important aspects. One is from the medical point of view, another is from the administration point of view. The medical point of view, you are aware that dietary services actually contribute to the recovery of the patient. That is from the nutritional point of view. There are various aspects like nutritional screening, nutritional assessment, then we have patient counseling, then various types of diets, modified diets, all that we'll go through one by one. It is a very, very important hospital support area which helps in actually recovery of the patients. Also, it is a very, very important administrative area in terms of patient satisfaction or dissatisfaction for that matter, and that is how its importance is there. So I will go through this topic in terms of objectives, in terms of definitions, various functions, then different types of diets, what are the planning parameters, equipment, then staffing and various quality implications, and I will try and show you some of the photographs also where the services are, dietary services are being provided. So what are the medical consideration of the dietary services? General nourishment, early recovery, that is post-operative cases or burns cases, then corrects deficiencies in terms of anemia, PEM, especially for the children hospital, very, very important area, protein, energy, malnutrition, remedy in metabolic disorders like lactose intolerance, then affords rest in terms of parenteral feeding as well as Ryle's tube feeding, liquid diet, all that preparation has to be done in a collaborative manner. Like body weight, nowadays obesity clinics are started where there is a collaboration between dietitians and physicians as well as surgeons, whereby you can control the obesity. Adjust food intake to the body's ability to metabolize the nutrients like hepatic failure and renal failure. It is very, very important. And as Professor Arora also has brought out about the administration, patient satisfaction, patient dissatisfaction, as I said, it's an important part of your hospital budget. Then various perishable goods also we need to consider, because it requires strict storage and handling protocol. Negligence will lead to foodborne diseases. Negligence also can lead to litigation under the FDA. Teamwork, excellent stores management, personal management and innovation is required in this important area from administrative point of view. Food service, as far as food service is concerned, it has to be scientifically prepared, nutritious and aimed at specific disease conditions. Various types of definitions which we look at in the dietary services are about the food. All substances, whether in a natural, manufactured or prepared form, which are part of the human diet. Dietetics is another, a science in itself, application of the science and art of human nutrition for the purpose of nourishing the body in health and disease. Then the dietitian is a person who is trained in the service of foods and nutrition, and very, very important person. We'll see the role and objectives and various scope of a dietitian which we can use. Therapeutic diet is another very important part of your dietary service. Use of food as an agent in effecting recovery from illness. Then what is the scope of the dietary service? It starts from procurement, storage and accounting of food materials, procurement and maintenance of plant and equipment, which is very, very important from hygiene point of view, issue of ration and materials for daily cooking, menu planning, recipe standardization, preparation and cooking of food, distribution of food, nutritional assessment, preparation of modified diets, patient education, training and research. Now, research is also a very, very important component of the dietary service. Then what are we looking at the objectives? These objectives are basically about nutritional assessment, nutritional screening, nutrition therapy, education and discharge planning for inpatients. I will also go one step ahead and say that it is very important to do outpatient assessment also in terms of diet and nutrition, and advice has to be given accordingly. A clinic has to be run in the outpatients also. The department aims to integrate clinical nutrition services with good food, taking into consideration patients' dietary parameters, and it has to be directed by the nutritionist.
Do we need to have that dietary counseling services in the OPD? When you are mentioning that we need to have some type of dietary services provided in the OPD.
Yes.
Can we have, this is just, just when you are mentioning this, I thought, can we have that dietary counseling clinics in the OPD when the patients are waiting, or can we show them some type of health education material over there, that nutrition education?
Definitely, definitely. There's a requirement of having a health education in the outpatient department in terms of diets, the especially different types of diets, what is required in terms of malnutrition, what is required in terms of obesity, and also a dietitian should be attending to the entire outpatient department. It is not possible for her or to screen entire lot of outpatient department, but at least selected patients, especially the diabetic clinic, hypertension clinic, renal clinic, all those clinics have to be provided with the dietary services. The dietary counseling is a must in these areas. As I said, 100% screening for inpatients, but at least partially, at least 20-30% patients for the outpatient department have to be given the counseling and nutritional assessment, nutritional screening. All those services have now become very important from a modern hospital point of view, because of various requirements which have come up in terms of various types of diseases, where the diet has become a very important factor in the recovery. So, as we are going ahead, there are various operating functions like general menu planning, selection and purchase of food, receipt and storage of food, cleanliness of the department, continuing training program and supervision of persons, patient education, research in the teaching hospitals, of course. Various types of diets are liquid diet, full diet, soft diet, modified diet and therapeutic diets. What we can say, low salt, low fat, fat-free diet, diabetic diet, liquid diets, and various types of feeds which are to be prepared for pediatric age group as well as geriatric age group equally it is there. So dietary services planning basis on 4 P's, what we call in hospital administration, that premises, plant and equipment, personnel, and the process. We will see to the extent possible all these into some details Mudaliar committee, in fact, has recommended a dietitian for all hospitals, more than 200 beds. But I would say even a smaller hospital would require services of dietitian. And the resources, these are the some space norms, which is approximately 50 square feet per bed for a 50-bedded hospital and 15 square feet per bed for 500-bedded hospital. General norm is around for 15 square feet per bed for this. A layout is in front of you that you have to have place for storekeeper, various types of cold stores, dry stores, day stores, cooking areas, preparation areas, trolley wash, pot wash, distribution area, and then the service loading. Dietitian's office, supervisor's office, staff rooms, and their change rooms have to be there as per the layout. This is a small layout of cafeteria in a private hospital where you have various types of bain marie and other equipment laid out, and the counters are there. Then various types of processes which are there in the food preparation are boiling, steaming, deep frying, shallow frying, roast, bake, grill, toast, microwaving. There are types of food distribution mechanisms, centralized food distribution or decentralized. Centralized is of course economical, you can better supervise, less waste, what Professor Arora was saying about pilferage aspect, less labor cost, and different types of foods. Of course, when it reaches the end point, there you may not get that much hot food or warm food. That is the only disadvantage I can see. Otherwise, a centralized food distribution is a very good system for food distribution. Various types of equipment which you can see in a modern kitchen and dietary service are bain marie, hot tables, food trolleys, ovens, infrared lamps, hot cabinets. And food hygiene being a very, very important aspect of the dietary service, it has to be given due attention. And I would just being short of time, I would just go on to the personnel. That is, you need to have a dietitian, chief dietitian, junior dietitian. Approximately, it is recommended that around 48 staff for 500-bedded hospital is to be provided. This actually is around 7% of total hospital staff. It depends. Dietitian is a very, very important aspect. As I said earlier also, we have discussed about this, that patient diet counseling, medical nutrition therapy, then planning of hospital menus for IPD patients is his task. Specialized nutrition support services, as I said, some people may be having a major surgery or a specific disease which will hamper their normal bowel functions. So there you need a specialized nutrition support services. Nutritional education and counseling for surgical and non-surgical. Weight loss clinic, as I mentioned earlier, is an important aspect. Then various types of softwares have come in the kitchen which can give you meal scheduling, meal cancellation, diet requisition slips can be produced, diet cancellation reports can be made, late admission reports, and therapeutic diets of different types. This is just one of the photographs of one of the kitchens. Then this is in a leading hotel. Then this is again a private hospital and in the PGMR.
I think Colonel Rao has given you enough food for thought. So we'll be breaking here. We'll take a break for 15 minutes, and when we come back, if you have got any question pertaining to dietary services, waste management, during these 15 minutes, you can compile your questions and throw your questions when we come back, and we'll love to answer your all questions. So we'll be back after 15 minutes.